On today's episode of On the Health Record, we welcome Dr. Justin Saliman, who's an orthopedic surgeon and the founder and CEO at OutcomeMD, a platform that tracks and measures patient-reported outcomes. Dr. Saliman has been on the show before, but he brings so much experience and knowledge to the world of healthcare and technology. We wanted to invite him back and get his thoughts on what's changed or not changed over the past couple of years. He's a tech enthusiast and a serial entrepreneur who began building software programs as a kid and started multiple businesses in his teen and young adult years. So it's not hard to see how he's combined his three passions into OutcomeMD, where reliable data meets better business incentives and quality care. We talk about the impact of online review culture on the healthcare system. We'll talk also about doctors' incentives and outcome marketing, among many other topics. Be prepared to learn a lot about the current and future states of value-based care and what OutcomeMD is doing about it. With all that being said, I hope you enjoy the episode. Let's play the tape. So, Justin, welcome to the show. Most folks are satisfied with running one business. Our guest today has his own medical practice and software company. And actually, before we recorded, you let me know that his medical surgical device company got sold in 2019 in January. So that's actually three companies. Justin, I'm sure you're super busy. You're doing all these things. Thank you for making the time to talk today. How are you doing today?
Thanks so much. I'm great. Nice to talk to you as well.
Yeah, so I understand that your family has kind of an engineering background. Can you speak to that and maybe how it reflects on you and how you approach medicine?
Yeah, you know, I always grew up working with my hands, with my dad building things. His dad was one of the chief engineers on the Hoover Dam. So I always thought mechanically about things and just sort of innovative with, you know, ways to solve problems and different techniques to improve the way we do things now. Mm-hmm.
And then the logical follow-up is, why didn't you go into engineering? What is it about medicine that kind of drew you to that?
Yeah, it's funny. I was interested in engineering and I actually got my degree in economics. So it's, and I ended up going to medical school. I'm interested in a lot of things and, medical school was because I want to be able to look back on my life when I'm 80. And at the time I was saying, you know, I want to be able to look back and really feel like I made a difference in people's lives. And you certainly can do that as a doctor. And then I started to realize that medical and med tech innovation can do that only on, not on a patient by patient basis, but actually on a massive scale. And I always had the entrepreneurial spirit. And so that's why I moved into these startups. You know, I still do surgery one day a week, but predominantly right now I'm running this software company.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I want to talk about all those things you do. Maybe you could tell me a little bit more about your journey, starting in medical school. So like, when did you kind of decide, you know, I'm always interested to hear from like doctors about how they kind of ended up where they're at. How did you decide you were going to be, you know, not just a surgeon, but an orthopedic surgeon? When did you fully commit to that? Was it kind of like before school or during? And then when did you start to think about, you know, delivering products outside of just, well, you know, a patient visit is not a product. So when did you start to think about delivering software products too?
Well, when I was young, I used to write computer software programs in BASIC. I mean, in the early, early days, you know, on a Commodore VIC-20. And I always was building things, like I said, and I was always starting companies. In medical school, I had they were called the Ultimate Patient Tracking Sheets. And it was sheets that were sold in medical bookstores across the country where you could peel off page by page and do your rounds on them, keep track of the patient's vital signs and medications and, you know, all sorts of stuff, and organize yourself when you had to speak in front of everyone. And I always had little companies like that. I owned a painting company when I was in college and, you know, always starting things. And then when I was in residency and fellowship, and orthopedics, look, you get to work with your hands, you use fun toys. Patients are relatively healthy. They're just broken and you get to put them back together. It's a great field. So I was obviously excited about that. In residency and fellowship, I kept a list of the things that looked ridiculous in what we did. And then I started going after my favorite ones. And I actually started a couple companies, one around a device for rotator cuff repair, and then one around a device for meniscus repair. I did start the meniscus repair company and had a term sheet with a big company that was going to, it was a terrific scenario. They had to sign that term sheet in March 2008 and the stock market crashed. So that opportunity went away. I raised venture capital around it, built this big company, hired a CEO to run it. I was the founder, chief medical officer, board member, but it was in Menlo Park and I didn't run the company. It ended up selling to Smith & Nephew in 2019. But throughout that company, I actually traveled the world and met with the average orthopedic surgeon and the famous orthopedic surgeon and saw what made them tick. And the problems with healthcare are many. And OutcomeMD, this new software company, solves so many of these problems. And I could see it, the vision of it, and there was no way I wasn't going to do it. I did a clinical study, a multi-center prospective study for Soterix, the surgical device company, and I saw what was really making doctors tick. The combination of the struggles of doing this study and seeing what really motivates doctors to do things in America and in the world brought out the desire to start the software company, which was started in 2016.
Awesome. Yeah. And then we spoke 2 years ago in 2018, and there's a great podcast, you know, on Spotify, on Apple, if you want to go find it. But, you know, since, you know, not everyone may have listened to that, why don't you tell us about OutcomeMD? Can you tell me about, you know, what's the problem that OutcomeMD is trying to solve here?
Yeah. So we solve two main problems. The first problem is that doctors don't track outcomes, neither do patients. Unless a doctor and a patient are doing a clinical study for research purposes, they do not keep track of what works and what doesn't work, believe it or not. And that's shocking to a lot of people. But, you know, when you walk into a doctor's office, they ask you whatever random three or four questions they think of to assess your symptoms, even though the perfect questions are sitting there in the medical literature, the patient-reported outcome questions that are objective because they've been validated against other ways to determine an outcome. And they're scored a certain way that's valid in the medical literature, and they're actually used for FDA studies and clinical trials. We really should be using them for clinical care, because then we have outcome data, and the outcome data is the key to things like disease cure identification, decision support, precision medicine, quality improvement, effective healthcare AI. And I say effective because if you take crap data and put it through AI, you'll get slightly less crappy data out. You take incredible medical outcome data obtained in a rigorous scientific way and then combine that with AI to correlate medical record data and to correlate confounding factor data, and you cure disease. And then also for best practices, outcome data is the key to being able to dial in best practices, and dialing in best practices is the key to value-based care, which is a big topic these days. The first problem we address is helping doctors track outcomes. But the problem is we're not really going to get massive adoption of outcome tracking by just solving that problem, because what's in it for the doctors and what's in it for the patients? So the other problem we had to solve is that doctors have misaligned business models. And that's a big problem. Doctors have very little incentives to get good outcomes. If I give you a 70% good shoulder and I'm super charming and nice to you and my office is organized, you will recommend me to your friends, even though for the rest of your life, you need to live with 30% of your pain and dysfunction. You'll just figure your shoulder was so bad, you're happy that I got you 70% better. While it may be the case that the surgeon down the street can give you a 100% perfect shoulder, but they're kind of a jerk, right? And their office is dirty. In the end, the patient is not going to go, your friend's not going to refer you to that doctor. They're going to figure anyone would have given them a 100% perfect shoulder. The doctor's kind of a jerk. Don't go to that doctor. But you as a patient, you don't go to a doctor for a friend. You go to a doctor for a cure. And if you could truly know that the doctor down the street can give you a perfect shoulder and that I can give you a 70% good shoulder, you would go to the one down the street, even if they're not as nice. It doesn't necessarily matter if I get a good outcome as long as I adequately kiss your butt, okay? doctors' reputations are driven by satisfaction, and it's tearing apart the American healthcare system. Yelp is great for restaurants, and it's toxic for healthcare. And I'll show you how OutcomeMD solves that problem by embracing Yelp and Google reviews and those types of things. And then the other thing is doctors have very little ability to market themselves. What do we have? How do we market ourselves? Pretty much the only way to do it is Google AdWords and optimizing our website. So we have to pay for a sponsored ad that's keyword-based through Google AdWords. And so all of this adds up to the doctor's focus is on patient catering, not patient care, right? And every doctor-patient interaction has an air of blackmail. That's why narcotic abuse is going up and up and up in this country, right? It directly parallels Yelp adoption in this country. If you want an MRI, I'll give you an MRI. Why do you want the MRI? First of all, because you don't trust me. And why should you trust me? You have no reason to trust me. Second of all, I'm going to give you the MRI that you're asking for. Even if I know you sprained your knee and you're going to be fine in 2 weeks, I need to satisfy you. My business model is dependent on making you satisfied, right? When we're in medical school, our altruism shifts. We're in medical school, we're focused on, you know, we care about the patient. We want to do the right by them. And that's where our altruism sits. And then later in life, we may still care about our patients. Of course we do. But the truth of the matter is the world becomes different. And now all of a sudden you have elderly parents that you want to pay to care for them. And you have kids and you want to send them through private school. And some of your altruism shifts to your nucleus. And that nucleus, the way you're altruistic for your nucleus is by making enough money to be able to support them in the ways that you want to. And as sad as that sounds, that's a reality of every business. Okay. And so my point is the two problems that OutcomeMD needed to solve were one, doctors don't track outcomes, neither do patients. And two, doctors have misaligned business models. And what we've created is a cycle of ever improving outcomes that ever improves the doctor's business, which also improves the outcomes, which improves the doctor's business.
So you talk about, improving outcomes, and I think you could call your, OutcomeMD, I think you could call it a kind of a solution management platform. I don't know if you'd agree with that.
Yeah, we call it, so we do two things. We are an outcome management and marketing system. Outcome management means not just do we obtain patient-reported outcomes, but we also correlate them with the electronic medical record data, obtain confounding factor data from the patient that makes it fair to the doctor. What if the patient's not compliant? What if they have a new injury? What if they have an adverse life event or stress, right? These things should be created and structured so that we can create inclusion and exclusion criteria like we would do for a study when we're looking at the data, okay? When we're being maybe judged by the data even, all right?
I was thinking about the data, all the inputs and why don't we already tie all this stuff together? Why isn't this already happening? And then,
Yeah, I mean, it's a different question. But in the end, the reason it's not happening is because we're not incentivizing the process properly, right? We should track outcomes. It's a decision support tool from day one because you score the patient's symptoms and understand them better, right? But we don't incentivize doctors or patients to do it. And that is our whole focus, is so that we don't, OutcomeMD is not necessarily interested in the 2% of doctors that want to track outcomes. We'd rather get the 98% of doctors who don't really care to track outcomes, but are willing to do it for the right reasons. OutcomeMD is a story of multiple value props. Look, we wouldn't have used Uber if it was cheaper. It's cheaper. You can order the car from your phone. You can see the car on its way to get you. When you get in, the car is not as stinky. You can pay by just getting out. You can rate your driver. Like when you add them all up, all of a sudden it's like, you know what? That's a no-brainer. I'm going to do that. And OutcomeMD is doing the same thing around outcome tracking. And I haven't explained why and how outcome marketing works, but outcome marketing makes you want to do outcome management because there's three things that every doctor cares about. We all care about, and it may not be in this order, but there's three things that all doctors care about. We all care about delivering good quality patient care. We all care about making a bunch of money. Everyone does. And we all care about having everybody love us, right? Reputation. And I'm just being straightforward. And so OutcomeMD delivers on all three of those things because doing those three things gets doctors and patients to track outcomes. What's in it for the patient? Well, we give them a fitness tracker like Experience. for some reason, when you go for a jog, even though you just experienced that jog, you're curious about what was your heart rate and how far did you run, you know, and how many steps did you take? So we do the same thing around your medical situation, where you can measure your symptoms and then track how they change relative to all the things that have affected you, right, over time. And then the other thing that's important to the patient is that the doctor has all the information that they need to make a truly informed, smart decision about their care. So now the doctors are saying, hey, patients, I want you to do this. This is important. It helps me make decisions and it helps me generate business, which I'll explain to you in a minute. And the patients want to see how they've improved. So they're curious, which gets us the follow-up data. And then how does it all work? Basically, for the patients who are doing really well, those patients love their doctors. The patients who get good outcomes are the ones who bring their doctors a bottle of scotch or a box of chocolates, right? To say thank you because they love them so much. So for those patients, we give them the opportunity after they see their follow-up results to endorse their doctors by posting their good outcomes, which is their graph and the visuals of how their symptoms have changed over time, to social media like Facebook or Twitter, for example. Mm-hmm. And the average Facebook user has 338 followers. So when one of their friends see the outcome improvement on the graph and that's posted as an image on this patient's Facebook, they're like, oh, well, my grandma has a spine problem. And so they click the Facebook image and it takes them to the doctor's website, where now the patient and now the friend of the patient can potentially go see that doctor. So it helps with lead generation and attracting new patients to the doctor who's willing to track outcomes. And it gets the doctor to focus on getting good outcomes, because only patients with good outcomes beyond a certain threshold have the opportunity to post. And the more posts they get, the more business they get. And so now for the first time ever, the doctors can focus on patient care instead of patient catering. My business is driven by delivering good outcomes rather than by kissing patients' butts, right? Mm-hmm. Which is the way it is now. Mm-hmm. So does that make sense? That ever improving cycle. If I focus on getting good outcomes, I get more business. The other thing is the patients can post on Yelp and Google reviews. And when they post, they're objective posts. My score went from a 15 to an 85. Thank you so much, Dr. Jones, for taking such good care of me. So now we're pushing objective data into the subjective review sites, which is even more meaningful to prospective patients who may be coming to research you, right? So for all these reasons, this cycle, it rewards the doctor and incentivizes them to make sure the outcomes are tracked and the patients get better care as a result, because doctors now inform their decisions better and have population data on all of their patients to be like, you know what? That implant actually doesn't work that well. I'm going to use the other one that's working better, right? So the doctors get better. The patients are better informed. And the whole thing is in the favor of value-based care and moving doctors towards evidence-based medicine, transparency, shared decision-making, best practices, precision medicine, because we integrate with 250 wearables and scales, right? So as it turns out, a patient who is depressed, one patient A might sleep longer, and that's a sign that they're more depressed. And patient B might sleep less, and that's a sign that they're depressed. So the wearable data is only helpful if you can correlate it with how their symptoms have changed, right? So it's really important that we have the outcomes and that we keep track of them, and that we leverage them to improve healthcare and drive doctors' business models.
Yeah, I guess the thing I'm thinking of, and very interesting stuff. I mean, all that was, there's almost like too much to talk about there. I don't know what to address. But the first thing I think of is, after all that, is, you know, you get what you measure in life. And so if you're just gathering data with no real goal in mind, like, it's easy to put on an Apple Watch and generate all this data. That's okay. You know, I am interested in kind of how many steps I walked today, or you know, how many calories did I burn? But it sounds like you're doing more than that, kind of with the data, and you're trying to tie kind of all these inputs, right? You talked about wearables and other things, and you're tying those to the outcomes. I guess, why weren't we doing that already? Is it just a really hard problem of, because I'm sure all doctors want to improve at what they do and all patients want to get better. So, you know, why isn't this already popular already? Is it just that the problem is so hard and too difficult that people pull their hair out?
Yeah. It's a really good question, actually. And the elevator pitch always lands with the next person saying, are you kidding me? You mean this isn't already happening? Mm-hmm. But the truth is it's not. And the reasons are multifactorial. I'll give you some examples. So first of all, OutcomeMD really is the vision for OutcomeMD, in my opinion, was started in 2006 when Michael Porter, the Harvard Business School competition theorist, described focusing the doctor's business models on getting good outcomes. And if we could do that, we'd go from the worst healthcare system in the world in America to the best overnight.
Can you explain what you mean by that? You've talked about doctors have the, I think you said wrong, but business strategy or
their business models are misaligned. Yeah.
Right. Business models are misaligned. And I've heard of, you know, fee for service and I've heard of value-based care. Can you talk about why the model is misaligned and just talk about the model we have today?
So the reason that outcomes aren't tracked. So Michael Porter started this company called International Consortium of Outcome Measures, ISCOM. And they believe that, and they're right, that some of the reason why it's hard to track outcomes is because there's not clear agreement on what should be tracked for each condition in medicine. So the medical literature, one group will study it one way and use one group of measures and endpoints, and another study might use different ones. And so they went around the world and brought in experts to actually make these clusters of assessments for every condition. They call them their standard sets. So that's one reason, is that we didn't have standard sets. And then the NIH in America, National Institute of Health, said, you know what? We think the reason the outcomes aren't tracked is because it's too burdensome to patients. Nobody wants to take surveys. So there's some sophisticated stuff called computer adaptive testing that we can put in to lower the question burden. So basically, they inform the next question by the previous answer. And so if it asks you if you can run around the block and you say no, it doesn't need to ask if you can run 3 miles. And so they created all these question sets around computer adaptive testing, super smart stuff. And they're right in part. And so is the International Consortium of Outcome Measures in part. And so we've embraced both of them. We are the technology partner for ISCOM, and we use the Promise API. But we also believe that it has to be a fitness tracker-like experience for the patient that's understandable to the doctor, patient, and payer in a simple way. And so that is our focus, is bringing it all together. It doesn't really matter for us what payer model they're in. Our concepts work across the board, whether it's an HMO or a PPO or fee-for-service or not. In America, fee-for-service is pretty much the way it works. And so the more you do, the more you make. And so OutcomeMD is focused on the more you do. Well, if you want to be able to do more, that means you need to get busy enough. And the way you get busy enough is by tracking outcomes. And then tracking outcomes actually does what value-based care is supposed to do, which is you can dial in best practices. You can figure out what works and what doesn't work so that patients get the right treatment the first time, not the fifth time, right? If there's 5 medicines I can put you on, and I put you on the wrong one 4 times, the 4 wrong ones before I get to the right 5th one, how much healthcare resources have we wasted by all the side effects to the 4 and the inadequate, incomplete resolution of your symptoms from the 4 wrong medications? Okay. Mm-hmm. So value-based care says, look, we're going to pay you a bundled amount. Let's say this is one example of value-based care for taking care of a certain patient population. And if you can take care of them and keep them healthy for less money, you can keep the margin. Right. And if you give them 5 treatment, if there's 5 possible drugs and you have to roll through all 5 to get to the right one, you're probably going to lose money. And that is a value-based care concept. But the key to doing it as a healthcare provider or as a healthcare system and succeeding is knowing what works and what doesn't work and guiding decisions. So decision support informed by outcome data and best practices that have been obtained and understood is the way to make the whole thing work. Michael Porter's vision, value-based care, and bringing the whole thing together. we just believe at OutcomeMD that the key to value-based care is tracking outcomes. Oh, everyone believes that. The key to being able to track outcomes is working with the system the way it exists today, which is have the doctor's business model drive them towards getting good outcomes.
Well said. Yeah, I think we can all agree, you know, better outcomes is what we want. So next kind of topic. As a podcaster, you know, I think about reviews and online feedback a lot, maybe more than I'd like to admit. You know, you have your own company, and you did mention earlier as a doctor, like, you know, as a provider, you do have to face the Google review and the Yelp, and you have to sort of participate there. There's almost probably like pressure to do so. Can you just talk about, like, you know, the landscape as a doctor with your own practice?
It's a great question too.
How do you work with reviews? What do you have to do?
Let's talk about reviews for a little bit. So there was an article published in JAMA, Journal of American Medical Association, republished actually by the AMA in a release, that had a sample size of 52,000. It's called the cost of satisfaction. So if you type in cost of satisfaction into Google, it'll probably come up. They found that if you use a subjective review site to find your doctor, and you choose a 5-star doctor, you're more likely to die. There's an inverse relationship between outcomes and subjective reviews. And why is that? Well, first of all, patients don't review doctors based on outcomes. It's all sorts of nonsense. Like, did they make me pay my copay? Did they give me Percocet when I asked for it, right? All these things that are blackmail, essentially, in the doctor-patient relationship. And that's what drives the reviews. More than anything else, okay? And second of all, the doctors can hire hackers to remove bad reviews. Mm-hmm. And so if I'm a 5-star doctor, it's very likely that I had hired a hacker to remove my negatives. Mm-hmm. And this is hard when you're on a podcast with an electronic medical record company, but the truth is most electronic medical record companies and most website hosts for doctors will send out subjective review questionnaires to patients. And if they say 5 stars, they'll push it to Yelp and Google reviews. And if they say 4 stars, they'll hold on to it for the doctor to do quality improvement, but they won't push it to the review sites. And so it's all gamed and it's all nonsense. And it has nothing to do with a doctor's ability to deliver a good outcome. It has everything to do with how successfully that doctor sold themselves to the patient and kissed their butt. Mm-hmm. And that is why they're so toxic. Like I said earlier, great for restaurants, toxic to healthcare. That's why our slogan is outcomes, not opinions. It has two meanings. Doctors should be using outcomes to guide their treatments, not their opinions. Not their gestalt, right? Mm-hmm. It's only an art of medicine because we don't have enough science. We should know the right thing to do every time, right? So it should be outcome-based, not opinion-based from the doctor side. And then the dual meaning, doctors should be able to focus on getting good outcomes, right? And it shouldn't be the patient's opinions of them, which means did I pay my copay and did I get Percocet? Did they adequately kiss my butt that drive my business? It should be my outcomes that drive my business. Right. I'm a great doctor, you know? So if that's how somebody feels that, then they should feel like they're going to be driven by it. Right. And every doctor thinks they're great. The truth is an individual doctor doesn't even know if they're any good. If I screw up your knee, you'll come in and see me 3 months after surgery. And I'll say, you just need to do more physical therapy. At 6 months after surgery, you'll never go back to me. You'll go back and see another doctor. And I'll think you did great. Meanwhile, that other surgeon maybe did a revision surgery on you. And since your outcome wasn't tracked in a way where the patient is curious to see how their scores changed, the outcome is lost. And because the doctors never score the symptoms to begin with, there's no way to scientifically gauge the symptom improvement. So the data is lost. The doctor thinks they're brilliant and that all their patients are doing great. And that's not the truth. We need to measure what matters, right? We need to measure how patient symptoms or quality of life is changing as a result of our treatments, because that is the key to everything. The outcome is everything.
Well said. And so I guess let's hammer home this idea of outcome marketing. You know, I guess the idea is if you have good outcomes, you're going to want to share them. I want to push back a little bit because, you know, PHI, personal health information, is protected under the law. You know, as consumers, we already have so much data that's like being taken. Why do you think patients want to share more? And why do you think now is the right time for outcome marketing?
Yeah, so this is riskless stuff for a patient. The patients certainly don't have to post. And it's them putting it on their own Facebook or Twitter or whatever they choose to put it on, right? Anything that's in their share doc on their phone. So there's no PHI problem. It's the patients making the decision to take this beautiful image that shows how much they've improved and share it with their community. And more, this type of thing is happening. In fact, most patients find their doctors on social media or review sites online. And so there's nothing wrong with a patient celebrating their good outcome. We're also helping the patients have catharsis. And we're also destigmatizing certain conditions. You know, when we first started releasing outcome marketing, we were worried about the mental health patients. Would they want to share? Amazingly, yes. Like crazy, they're sharing their outcomes. Their anxiety is so much better, right? Thank you so much, doctor, for helping me with this problem or whatever, right? Their PTSD. People share PTSD left and right when they get better. So the point is there's no PHI risk here. It's the patient's choice to share it. We would never, nothing's shared by OutcomeMD, right? And then anything that we do create testimonial pages that are outcome-based for doctors, but it doesn't share PHI. It's just like spine patient, this much improvement, you know? And it's authenticated by OutcomeMD, meaning we authenticate that that data that's on the doctor's website is true and real, and that it was obtained from a patient and our reputation is on the line. We're not making stuff up. It literally came straight from the patient's phone. We're populating this testimonial. It's an outcome-based testimonial that doesn't say a patient's name anywhere, right? Or any identifying information. So we're completely HIPAA compliant in every way. And there's nothing being shared that's not like on social media or anything that that is not obviously something that the patient wants to share or they wouldn't do it. Mm-hmm. Did that answer your question?
Yeah, yeah, it did. That was really good. Let's keep talking about kind of value-based care and the current state of it, because I think it is the most interesting kind of thing I think of, you know, and one of the most interesting driving forces in healthcare in the U.S. today. So, you know, currently the model, like currently the way doctors get reimbursed is actually it's changing, right? Like it used to be strictly fee for service, and recently there have been changes with MIPS and MACRA. Correct me if I'm wrong. Where
yeah, MACRA and MIPS is an attempt to benchmark doctors and to be able to understand quality and to make sure the doctors are trying to deliver quality care and keep track of whether they are or are not delivering quality care. In my opinion, like I said, the outcome is everything. If we tracked outcomes, there would be no need for MACRA and MIPS. If we tracked outcomes, there would be no need for doctors to be certified. Why be board certified? You know what that means? That means I have to take some test about the basic science, or I have to have somebody look through my patient lists and say, yes, you did this the way the medical literature suggests you should do it. And I have to pay thousands of dollars to maintain board certification. And in the end, is it really helpful to anyone? Maybe it is. And I'm not suggesting we shouldn't do it with no other system in place, but isn't it more valuable to be outcome certified?
Yeah.
So if I'm outcome certified and if my outcomes are good, then do you care if I'm board certified? You know, do you care, Medicare, about MACRA and MIPS and all the infrastructure and all this if you have outcome data? No, they don't. Where Medicare, I think, wants to move with this is benchmarking doctors. And eventually, they've been very clear, the future of MACRA and MIPS is patient-reported outcomes, exactly what we're doing. Mm-hmm. Only the way Medicare wants to incentivize doing it is by saying, look, if you don't do it, we're not going to pay you. And that's okay, because they realize the importance of the outcome data. What we're saying in OutcomeMD is there actually may be a better way. And I think someday Medicare will embrace what we're doing and see that this is the way it should be done, because this is the way to make it happen quickly in our lifetime, have value-based care delivered. Mm-hmm. Align the doctor's business model with getting good outcomes. That's the key. And that is what MACRA and MIPS is trying to do. They're trying to align the doctor's business model with an attempt to report to them that they're delivering quality care, mm-hmm. which is kind of similar. And the reason they would make everyone do PROs, but it's just really hard to do because doctors don't know how to track outcomes. Patients don't know how to track outcomes. There wasn't a good software, in my opinion, to do it. And Macro and MIPS wants to make sure it's a good software in order to qualify it. And they have all these hurdles you have to jump through in order to be a software. And even then, it satisfied this one tiny little piece of MIPS. So it's not meaningful enough to clinicians. So in the end, Medicare is going to have to come on board. And I think they will eventually when they see this actually working on a massive scale. And that's what we're focused on. Remember, it's not the 2% that want to track outcomes now. It's the 98% of doctors who just want to practice medicine and deliver good care and also be able to put food on the table in a significant way. Not really nice food on the table. I think that this is all going to come together over the next, hopefully few, but probably several years into one ubiquitous system. And I do believe that as a result, the American medical system is going to become the best in the world. I know we're one of the worst right now. Mm-hmm. It always makes me angry that Americans are so proud of NASA and so proud of all of American technology and American tech companies. And they're not proud, or at least they don't seem proud or even aware that we in America are at the forefront of medical innovation. MedTech, no country even comes close to the amount of innovation and sophistication in medicine that America has. Yes, our system is broken because of what I've been talking about. Yeah, fee-for-service and subjective reviews, bad scenario. But focused on outcomes, we can become the best system ever. And then we have the data, okay, to actually take it to the next level through the most valuable data in the world is outcome data, medical outcome data. You take it with AI, you take it with a buccal swab of the mucosa plus EHR data, and all of a sudden we can do predictive analytics and know exactly what the right treatment is for phenotypically similar patients. It's really, really exciting, cool stuff that's coming in the future.
Let's bookmark it. Let's put a pin in it. I just wanted to kind of summarize what I've learned so far. So, you know, from speaking with you, it sounds like one, the business models are pretty screwed up. And it sounds like there's a lot of ways to maybe put a small fortune into either optimizing your search engine optimization or, you know, putting money into lead generation and not actually, and it's a lot of time and money spent on exactly that lead generation, getting patients in the door, but not necessarily treating patients better. And your platform gives doctors a way, you know, it's a platform, it's a way to track patient outcomes, improve as a medical provider, and not just your, you know, putting lipstick on a pig and making your Google review sheet look really good. So, you know, you have that platform, that's your solution. Justin, I was hoping you could take me through maybe not a day in the life, but, you know, how you would interact with OutcomeMD and maybe an electronic health record on a daily basis as a surgeon. You know, take me through just
sure.
What does that look like when you're using your application?
So with a new patient, I walk into the office. My staff, when the patient calls the office, they send them the assessment that's appropriate to what they're in need of based on their condition. Mm-hmm. They're assessed. And then when I walk into the office, I know that patient's score. I talk to them about their score. They actually love me more because I cared enough to measure their symptoms and to talk about where they sit on the spectrum of symptoms. Then they go and they have their treatment, whether it's physical therapy, medication, surgery. And at various time points in the future, they're followed up remotely. And I look at those scores. If the patient is doing worse, guess what happens? I get a text. And the text is a link. I face ID into the OutcomeMD iOS app. Shows me how they've gotten better or shows me how they've gotten worse. I can press one button and call them or press the other button and call them with caller ID blocked. But for a patient, they just finished their symptom assessment. They're not shocked that they're worse because they feel worse. But they see this number and a few minutes later, their phone rings and it's me calling them. That's good care. Tracking outcomes improves outcomes. It's been proven from decision support reasons and from care management reasons and for informing treatments based on populations of patients, which is best practices. So that's a day in the life. Literally, if they're doing great, then I get an email saying, hey, you just got another great post on Facebook. If they're doing poorly, I can intervene. And everything is done empathetic to the doctor, meaning you can set it so that you're only notified for the rare specific scenarios. I only want to be notified on patients whose angina gets worse when they're also on nitroglycerin and they're in the age group of 70 to 100 and they have a status post MI and they're doing poorly and getting worse below a score of 40. So boom, that's one type of notification I'll get. And for everyone else, it's a different thresholds for my nurse and my care manager. So now we can manage the population remotely and keep these patients out of the hospital, keep them from needing additional care, get to them before they're in trouble, right? Which is another value-based care concept. Less care because we're catching things sooner and doing the right thing the first time, right? That's a day in the life.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. I want to hear about using EHRs. You know, you're a doctor, you practice medicine, you use these things on a regular basis. EHRs are actually notoriously hard to use and confusing. So can you tell me, you know, what makes using EHRs hard for you as a doctor today? You can feel free to use DrChrono as an example or just blanket statement.
Well, one of the beauties of EHR is that it gathers all the information you need right there. Okay. So now when you take that data, and I'm always going to play it back to outcomes because the EHR is the repository for their procedures, diagnoses, medications, patient demographics and phenotype information, like maybe their BMI and their race and their medical comorbidities. And when I take all that data and now I can correlate it with outcome data, all right, now my outcome data is much more meaningful because there's EHR data to make sense of it, right? And to make it valuable to the patient and the doctor. So you can't have any of these in a vacuum are less valuable. EHR data without outcome data is just a repository of information, but EHR data with outcome data, and now you can do magical things. So we've been using electronic medical records for a while now, and now it's time that we leverage all that data to improve care in a dramatic way. DrChrono has a really nice user interface that's friendly for doctors, especially doctors on the go. Who are more on the forefront of technology, and it's cloud-based, which makes it very easy for companies like OutcomeMD to integrate and to deliver a really good product. And because of the way DrChrono was built, we can offer things on DrChrono that we can't offer on any other electronic medical record system. Very cool things like the patient report outcome questions and answers color-coded for severity push into the DrChrono medical note with HTML formatting. The scores go into the assessment section. The review of systems go into the review of systems section. Chief complaint goes into the chief complaint section. And all of a sudden, the doctor's note is written without the doctor even having to write a single thing. So now the doctor just puts in their physical exam and they can bill at a higher level of service, right? These things are really great because think about what happens with a doctor and a patient. The doctor's sitting at their keyboard typing the whole time, never looking at the patient. Patients feel very disconnected from a doctor, and doctors hate it. They feel like they have to document real fast, real quickly, because if they don't, they're going to get audited, and then they're going to have to pay all this money back because they didn't document adequately to defend that level of service. Some of that can be done by the patient ahead of time by taking their patient-reported outcome questions. So that's a really cool thing that DrChrono can do for the users, is literally auto-document most of the note before the doctor even walks in the room. Really cool stuff. We at OutcomeMD never wanted to build a medical record company, and we're never going to. We partner with the best medical record companies like DrChrono, so that together, DrChrono plus OutcomeMD is the ultimate outcome management system.
Yeah, that's interesting. I imagine that's a really hard balance to strike, where you're in the patient's visit and you're talking to the patient and you got to take notes down and you got to strike this balance between, you know, I got to take down really quality notes because I could always get audited and people might, you know, I'll need good notes, right? It's always good to have good notes. And then on the other hand, it's like, this patient is going to evaluate me publicly or, you know, in some way. And it's not even based on the outcome. It's based on like how they freaking feel in this room right now. So if I'm taking good notes, I might actually hurt my, my future leads. Do you find that?
It hurts your business model to document your notes, but it also helps your business model to document your notes. Cause if you get audited, you're in big trouble. Yeah. So, you know, it's a double-edged sword on that one. And so we help you auto document and we help you worry a little bit less about kissing the patient's butt and more about, look, let's just focus on how we get them a really good outcome. And if we get them a really good outcome, we're going to end up with more business as a result.
Yeah. Okay. And speaking of better outcomes, you know, we've talked about software, we've talked about all this potential. How does big data and artificial intelligence fit into this whole thing?
Yeah. So, you know, the ultimate decision support tools are ones that would suggest the right treatment based on the phenotype of the patient, based on data from all over the world, outcome data from similar patients. So, you know, and AI helps us dial that in. And I ultimately would like to deliver that decision support tool in EHRs like DrChrono, where the doctor sitting in front of the patient at the point of care can do an instant prospective multi-center randomized controlled trial on phenotypically similar patients right there in front of the patient so that they can figure out what's the best treatment today for that patient.
That would be amazing. I have just maybe a wrap-up question. Or do you have anything to add on the, you know, the outcome marketing, you know, what the difficulties are and why this is the future?
What the difficulties are with outcome marketing? You know, I mean, outcome marketing is a whole platform. It's not just posts. It's also testimonial pages and some really cool things.
I didn't mean problems with your outcome marketing. I meant what people are doing today, like just in general, like why.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. There is no good, like there are no doctor marketing softwares in existence that I've ever seen. There are medical marketing companies, and what do? They post things to your Twitter and your LinkedIn, and they blog about you, and you could pay them a lot of money. Mm-hmm. And the average doctor pays $1,500 for marketing to places like Google AdWords for keyword searches, like I said before, and to sponsored above it, you know? And besides that, you have no way to market yourself. We all pay web developers to make websites, you know, and we try to drive traffic to those websites. And a lot of the doctors that focus on marketing a lot and put a lot of their energy into it get busier. And they're also probably the worst doctors. So what I'm suggesting is that word of mouth from good outcomes is what we ignite. And that is where I think it really should be. That's what should drive your business, is getting good outcomes, which can ignite positive word of mouth, right? Mm-hmm. Outcome-based word of mouth, rather than spending money on these other avenues, which are basically just trying to throw yourself in front of patients, meaning they type in a keyword, you throw an ad in front of their face so that they'll hopefully click on your website, right? That just is a pretty sad way of marketing. Other businesses have better ways to market themselves, you know, but doctors really don't. And everything sounds like a commercial or an advertisement. And it's weird when it's for health. Mm-hmm. Like a radio ad for you to come to a doctor is a little odd, right? It's like the fact that you need to put the commercial out there may imply that you don't have enough word of mouth business, right? So it might actually hurt you in some ways. I don't know that that's totally true, but because you still, you know, big health systems will do radio ads, but certainly it lands better if there's natural, organic outcome posting happening, right? That's mm-hmm. the future.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, it feels almost like trying to fit a square peg in a round hole where, you know, these review sites, Google Review, Yelp, they were kind of designed as these like blanket review sites. And I don't think ever they had, you know, your use case in mind. They were never thinking about reviewing medical providers. And maybe, you know, let's scratch our heads for a sec here and think, you know, should we have the same system? Should we have one system for reviewing medical providers that we have for reviewing, you know, the local pizza shop? I don't, sounds wrong.
Yeah, they're just different. They're different.
Yeah. All right. Well, hard to do a podcast these days without talking about COVID. Can you tell us briefly maybe how COVID has affected things for you and your practice? And if things haven't changed that much, can you talk about how it's affected other doctors with their own practices? And let's leave hospitals out for this question. I'm just sort of interested in solo providers or small groups. Any insights there?
Yeah, I mean, I think COVID has been challenging for everyone. It's the infrastructure. Not only is it that you can't see a lot of patients in the office, perhaps, but it's also all of the fear. For a long time within the medical space, meaning the doctors, the nurses, the staff, fear of getting sick from one of the patients. So at least most of the healthcare workers are or can be vaccinated in the next little bit here. That's super exciting. And then the patients also always worry that they come in and they're going to get something from someone else, right? So at least they don't have to worry about the healthcare providers. And as the vaccine rolls out, really, I think things are going to become a lot easier, obviously, and a lot better. That you can definitely see the light. And I think it's made tools like OutcomeMD more relevant, perhaps, because you can remotely monitor patients and keep track of how they're doing when they're not actually in front of you. But I also think that once COVID, this particular scare is over, for sure telemedicine will stick some, but there's intangibles with being face-to-face with patients. And we'll go back to seeing patients in the office and things will go back to normal. But we're not quite there yet. And so, you know, it's been certainly an interesting, crazy year for doctors, patients, and humans, you know?
Have you done telemedicine? I know you practice surgery, so maybe that doesn't make sense, but, have you gotten to do that?
Yeah. So outpatient surgery at a surgery center, which is what I do one day a week, is still doable. All the patients are tested negative for COVID 48 hours beforehand. And at this point, most of the clinicians have been immunized. So probably the surgery center is the safest place in the whole world right now you could possibly go because all the patients are tested and all the staff and doctors are immunized, at least in at least at my surgery centers in Beverly Hills. We took a few weeks off and then started working again, because people had problems and, you know, it's hard to say, well, COVID's here, so live in severe pain or, you know, live with severe problems. So, you know, some things are elective, meaning it's not going to kill you, just like it's not going to kill you to live in severe pain, or it's not going to kill you to not have the ability to walk, you know? And I'm an orthopedic surgeon by training. So, you know, it's important. Now, certainly the types of cases that we were doing were altered. So in the early days, you were only doing the things where patients were in really bad shape. And now as things improve, it's a different story. You don't do it now. And we're not operating inpatient because the hospitals are still overwhelmed. And so the elective surgeries happening inside of hospitals have pretty much closed down still in Los Angeles anyway. But the surgery centers are still up and running because they were never taking care of COVID patients to begin with. So they're not overwhelmed.
And I guess last year, I got one more question after, but can you speak to the telemedicine bit? You know, I have to do all my meetings now remotely and, you know, there's challenges doing things over Zoom. And I'm sure there's like even more challenges when you're trying to treat a patient. Can you speak to just how the medical community has maybe, I don't know what the word is, accepted that they have to do this? And what's the general feel? What's the gut feel with telemedicine right now? Are we really excited about it? Or do we just like, can't wait to get back into the office?
I think it's somewhere in between. Reimbursement has improved, like the reimbursability of telemedicine and remote patient monitoring has improved through some of these emergency exceptions that were made by CMS, and the insurance companies often follow. And so that's a good thing. And I think because of it, some of those will stick. And if doctors can get paid to do remote monitoring and to do telemedicine, then they will. I do think that there's always the place where, like, if you can't do a physical exam, if you can't get your hands on a patient, if you can't sit in front of them, there are some things that are lost. And can that do damage? Sure, it can. You can make a bad decision because you didn't have enough information. That's what I was talking about before, in terms of you got to have the right information to make the right decision. And some of it is missing when you're not in the office, but a lot of it's missing if a patient never comes into the office and never sees a doctor. And so for the patients who live in a remote community, a rural area, for them to be able to get good care very easily, you know, and find specialists, what a gift this has been to open the world's eyes to the possibility of being able to talk to a doctor without sitting right in front of them. And it's given a big boost to that industry. And I think there is a lot of value in it. I don't think it is the forever, meaning that this level of adoption of these services will not continue, but it'll be certainly higher than the pre-COVID world.
Well, you know, Justin, you got to get to the door, so maybe we can wrap it up here. Yeah, it was a great podcast. Thank you for making the time. And if you're listening at this point, thanks for listening through to the whole to the end. Justin, it's been a pleasure having you back on the podcast. Let's make sure to try to get you back on here soon. Maybe less than 2 years from now. Let's maybe book it for sooner than that. Hope that sounds good.
Great. Thanks so much. Really appreciate you.
Definitely. All right. Bye.
Bye.